Secocta Comedy Funhouse Network. Know that it's Couch Pilots, the show that dares to fly into the unknown territory of awful television pilots of the past. My name is Jason, a.k.a. the Black Ben Kenobi, and across from me, as always, is my fellow captain and yours. His name is Philip Restisher. Evening, Captain.
Good evening, Captain. How are you?
Great. You look great in your shades.
Well, these are prescription shades.
Please do tell.
Well, I'm having some issues with my sight, and the doctor said you shouldn't fly, and you have to wear these glasses.
Okay, that's a pretty big deal.
Because my eyes are dilated. And so I was like, cool.
And maybe.
He put drops in this morning. He said that by midnight tonight, I should be able to see fine, and it's 6 o'clock now. By the time we get up in the plane, I figure, how hard is it? Because you get it up. And you bring it down.
And then you do all the stuff in the middle.
But all the stuff in the middle is nothing compared to getting it up and bringing it down. I just have to make sure that, like, if I feel like I'm leaning too far to the left, oops, we're going too far to the left. That's a balance issue.
A big deal, though. Because, you know what, thankfully, in a minute we'll give you an update on DSJ and his whereabouts. If you go a little bit to the left, DSJ is going to be waiting out there for days waiting for us to land because we're going to be off track.
Right. Well, I got an app. A GPS for planes app, and this is Air Force One. It should fly itself.
It practically
does. There is a button that says "Fly myself."
Yeah, that's honestly when we were given the tour to say, "Is this, you know, do you want to finalize this?" Sure. It took both of our Herbie Hancocks to sign off on it, and I saw that red button, and that really did seal the deal for me.
Oh yeah,
I said, "Just fly yourself." You know what? Sold.
In case of emergency, fly yourself.
Just fly. Yeah.
You know, it's got a little glass,
like a little hinged box, right?
Hinged box. You can either open it, like just lift it up, mm-hmm. or you can just smash it with something.
There is like a little hammer there, like almost like a little toy hammer that you can smash the glass. Right. And it looks like it's never been used, but you and I,
it's like on a chain.
We really use it all the time.
Yeah.
Like, or it's even like, because the button says just fly yourself. It's kind of even worn out a little bit since we've been using it so much.
Right. So I think we'll be okay. I mean, if you're nervous, I can sit out.
No, okay. I don't go up there without you. Uh-huh. And I hope that you feel the same about me.
I don't get it up without you.
Yeah, and I don't bring it down without you, or do the stuff in the middle. So that explains the glasses. I think it's a great look.
Thanks.
I mean, heal up and then keep wearing them.
I told one of the baggage guys that brings all the bags and puts them in, because mm-hmm. a lot of our listeners have bags. Mm-hmm. And I told him, I said, hey, I'm not wearing these to look cool. These are for medical purposes. And he said, I wish you would have told me they were to make you look cool.
Is this DSB you're talking about?
No.
Down Syndrome Bob?
No.
No? Okay. Because he does some of the luggage, but he wasn't in there, did
no,
I?
No,
okay.
No. It was some guy in there. Some Puerto Rican guy.
Okay.
Never mind.
El Syndrome Day? Okay, so, I mean, speaking of the devil, right?
Sure.
Not Satan himself, but surely...
Satan!
DSJ.
Right. Yeah.
Yes. A sigh of relief.
As frequent listeners know, mm-hmm. For the last couple of episodes, he's been gone. He disappeared. He went out with us drinking with me, you, and Captain Andrew.
Yeah.
And you were supposed to take him home.
I do. Like, as we were taking off, I was like, oh, crap, it was me. Like, everything was starting to click into place. And I thought you were watching him, and you thought I was watching him. It was on me. So I kind of let him slip through the cracks.
Sure. And then, you know, so we didn't see him that week. And then his mom hadn't seen him, and nobody had heard.
She was pissed.
Yeah, she was pissed. But then I think she felt some relief after about a week, because she thought he was dead. You remember?
And isn't that really the relief of any...
Parent yes.
of someone who is a mentally challenged child.
Sure,
the ultimate relief.
The ability to go on a cruise and not have to worry about your child.
Oh, boy. I think that is the ultimate relief. That's right. But unfortunately, and I think she's callous to a point where she recognizes that, what would she do? Who is she without John?
Sure. She doesn't know what her life was before him.
And he's back.
Right.
Thank God he's back.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk about where we found him?
Well... remembered that he has a special watch on.
Yeah.
And it has a tracking device. We
told him it was an iWatch.
Yeah, we told him it was an iWatch.
Or an Apple Watch.
Yeah, it was basically. And we had completely forgot that we had that. It came with the plane. Mm-hmm. It came with Air Force One.
Because Barack Obama used to wear that all the time so they could keep track of him.
Right. And we had given it to him, you know, to DSJ because he likes shiny things.
And he's like, I'm a lame duck. I don't need this. Popped it off. And I was like, I don't want this. I don't want someone tracking me. And he's like, we'll just tell DSJ.
Right.
That it's an Apple Watch. In that case, I'd never seen him put a watch on so fast in his life.
Right. So we remembered, hey, let's turn this on. We turned it on, and it led us to a field in Wyoming.
Yeah.
And so we flew the plane out there, you know, brought it down right in the field.
I brought it down. You did this stuff, if I remember correctly, in the middle.
Yeah, in the middle. And we were like, you know, DSJ, where have you been, man? And he just had a smile on his face. He hadn't showered.
No.
His clothes were all dirty and tattered.
Yeah. And you know what? You know what I noticed, too? He had a wedding ring on.
Yeah, I was going to let him talk about that in case he ever come on. But, yeah, so supposedly he's married. We can't figure out all the details. He just kept showing us pictures of Marilyn Monroe that he had in his wallet.
He had a bunch of receipts that traced it back to Vegas. Somehow he got to Vegas, sure. I think, and then headed north to Wyoming. And we're still kind of putting together exactly what happened. But it looks, I mean, the documentation's there. I think he's hitched.
I got married in Las Vegas, and it's the same paperwork that I've got.
Mm-hmm.
And so we really haven't found out about this girl. We don't want to release her name yet because we need to make sure everything is on the up and up.
Yeah, that's right.
I make sure she wasn't forced to do anything.
But the end of the story basically is he's safe and sound.
Yeah.
We have him back. We got the golden cones to the rightful owner, and he's out there ready to wave us into the air and ultimately right back down.
Right. For the past week, we were kind of noticing he was just a little out of it, acting a little odd, walking funny, walking oddly. And so we've spent the last week, we had him come in every other day. And just kind of go through his normal routine and make sure that he's still on the
up and up. Get him back on track and make sure he's back in his routine.
Sure.
So there's the answer right there.
Yeah. So
found in a field in Wyoming, married, apparently had the time of his life. I would imagine there's a pretty big debt with all those receipts I saw, but at least he's safe and sound.
Right. Hopefully we'll be able to dive into the story more as we find out. But I know a lot of our listeners were very concerned about DSJ, and we were too.
The fan feedback on him alone has always mounted to more than the fan feedback for you and I, but now it's like tenfold. Where is this man?
Right.
I get it. I totally get it. I wanted to know too. But let's put that aside.
Okay.
And let's focus on the fan feedback for the show. DSJ gets it all the time. But we have some this week, so let's focus on that. I think you have that handy.
Yeah, we've got quite a bit here. I'm going to save some of it for our next show, but let's go ahead and get into some of this here. Sorry, my computer's not working correctly.
Now, is this through Twitter or Facebook?
Facebook seems to be the creme de la creme, the way that most people...
The default, huh?
The default. A while back, I posted the original promo photo. Mm-hmm. Say that.
Promo photo.
Yeah, promo photo. The one of us back to back.
Yeah.
It was the original Couch Pilots promo.
It was picture. Either right before or right after we had kissed.
I think it was right before because we both looked happy.
Mm-hmm.
And so I posted it. I was just updating some of our Facebook. You know, you can update your profiles and your there's a big picture that goes behind it. I don't know what that's called.
Me neither.
So, you know, and I was just posting, trying to get some more traction on this stuff. And a gentleman named Doug Stewart, who you met at the marathon.
Okay,
him and his lovely wife came over.
Oh, yeah.
And it says, you guys look grumpy, out of beer, ?
Mm.
I think that was the one we had our arms crossed. We were back to back. We were kind of like trying to look hardcore.
We were, and that can often come off as being grumpy.
Right, but we weren't grumpy.
No, we love what we do.
Brian Mitchell, who has been on the show before.
Yes.
Someone forgot to clean the freaking plane again before taking off, didn't they? Because the photo was of the kitchen plane we had.
Yeah, that one did get messy. We didn't really keep up with it. Right. We knew we were getting rid of it, so.
And Carrie Oakley, who was... A beautiful woman.
Who was a beautiful woman?
Oh, she still is a beautiful woman. She sold me my house.
Oh, okay.
She's the one I would like to get you set up with.
Great. But she, you said originally she said was beautiful, but she is beautiful.
Oh, she is beautiful.
Then I'm interested.
She put Thug Life.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
I mean, that's what we were living in the beginning of this before the money started rolling in. Jeb, you remember Jeb?
Love Jeb.
He hasn't been on in a long time. Haven't heard from him in a while.
It's been a while.
It's been a while. And then he posted Podcast Badasses.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah, he's not wrong.
Right. I mean, we could sit here all day and deny it, but why? It's true. And then Lori Garcia, of course, she goes, "You guys look great, FYI, I'm Puerto Rican." And so that was really important because we were saying that she was Spanish?
Illegal.
Illegal. But if she's from Puerto Rico, which is kind of a state.
Yeah, you know, this is, I think, a great opportunity for us to announce that our push at Comic-Con, or not, CouchCon, rather, we are really going to be pushing getting Puerto Rico as that 51st state.
Yeah, that's...
I know it's going to screw up a lot of things. It's going to mess with the flag. You know, a 50 is divisible by 10. That's nice. But screw it. They've been down there sweating, shucking and jiving long enough. They need to be part of this union.
Right.
If that means getting her family over here, that's exactly what we're going to do.
You know, we're taxing them.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
So... only taxation with representation.
Yeah, they need some representatives.
Right. And then one more. I posted another, the original color artwork of our logos. I just kind of updated, you know. And Dawn Witt says, "You're on iHeartRadio!" Exclamation point. Cool! Exclamation point, exclamation point. So, folks, if you listen to iHeartRadio, you can use that one as well.
We are on the forefront of all these different formats. Google Play, iTunes, the Android one, the iHeart thing, right?
Sure.
You can find us anywhere. You can go right to our website if
anywhere
you want.
Where podcasts are available.
That's right.
And as you know, we have a voicemail line, and it's
I'm aware of that. Yeah, absolutely.
910-PILOTS-1.
Yep.
We've had some great feedback from.
If
you need that decoded, do you have that decoded somewhere?
Yeah, absolutely. That is going to be 910-745-6871. You can call in anytime. I would suggest in the middle of the night. And then you can leave a message there, and then we'll be happy to get back with you or talk about it on the show. And probably most importantly, not only for this call, but all the fan feedback we received tonight, you're getting frequent flyer points. Getting frequent flyer points.
And we have a special voicemail that was left to us, and I know we didn't talk about this one. Usually we talk about stuff. We've got
a new one.
I guess you could say that we have a new one. I'll go ahead and play.
I don't know why you say it like that.
Hi, big fan here. You guys talked about me in the last episode, American Nuclear, about the face-to-face with Captain Rushesher. He mentioned the coitus that I've had with the Black Magistry. Well, I'll tell you what. That coitus led to a thing growing up inside my fun bun. You know what it's going to need when it busts out? Child support. You know what the Black Magistry offered? Frequent flyer points. Not cash, not checks, not surprise prizes, but frequent flyer points. Even though he can bring it up and bring it down, but can't pull out, I still love the show. I will be listening to the episodes while giving birth. Tell DSJ that I'll be naming the kid after him, and you tell that Black Magistry to pay up. All right, I gotta go. I think my water broke. Good day.
Wow.
That is disheartening.
First of all, I just wanted to say that she obviously needs to get somewhere where her cell service is not so crackly. So I apologize to the listeners for that. But
she has iWireless.
Oh, that
it's a bad service.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, women with not a lot of money often use that kind of phone technology.
And I let me just say,
this, I think it's what they call it, a burn phone, where you can just get rid of it at any time.
That's exactly right. And that's what she's using.
Like drug dealers, hookers, and just all around shady people.
And I hate to draw those parallels to this young lady, but that's absolutely what we're dealing with, is someone who is kind of out of their gourd on hop juice and go-go pills, you know, whatever the slang is on the street right now. This person is clearly out of their mind. You know, did I have an encounter with this person? Absolutely.
How many times?
That's, I don't know how that's relevant, but yes.
Okay. It only takes one time to make a baby.
That's what I've heard, and that's what I think we're hearing on this voicemail today.
Yeah, and that kind of concerns me for multiple reasons.
Right.
A, we have a company together. We have Couch Pilots, and I am concerned that my assets will have to be accounted for in this because it's kind of a marriage we have. And so my money is your money in regards to podcasting.
Right.
And the other is, you know, the wild nights you have.
You can't hold my hand every step of the way in my
life. I can't. I mean, I'm the mature one.
Sure.
Because I do everything in the middle.
Yeah.
You know, are you ready to handle this situation? This is a life-changing situation.
We are working very closely with local hospitals and the food bank on being able to take your frequent flyer points and convert them to goods and services rendered.
Mm-hmm.
So when I offer
like Bitcoins, we're going to make them – frequent flyer points are eventually going to be the same thing as Bitcoins.
Eventually.
You know how much a Bitcoin is worth right now?
A ton.
Supposedly it's worth like – one Bitcoin is worth like thousands and thousands of dollars.
That's exactly right.
And why shouldn't frequent flyer points be that?
And they will. And they will. So when I offer these up –
she's
going to
get all this money.
Well, it will translate that eventually. So when she's giving birth, I mean, and say, hey, I want some money. I don't have liquid assets, okay? I can't just hand over money to someone. So what I do have is frequent flyer points. And if those convert to cash or goods, like I said, goods and services rendered, why not use that?
Okay.
So I don't know what this person is complaining about. But it is very disappointing that they would call and make an error.
Very threatening.
I feel very exposed almost here. And this, I come to this plane week after week to be free and feel safe.
Mm-hmm.
This is, I mean, arguably the safest plane in the world, Air Force One.
Oh, yeah, definitely. That's why we paid the extra money for it.
Yeah. So when I hear a voicemail like that, it is alarming. It's concerning. I am. I feel naked. And she, I've almost
afraid?
A little afraid, sure. Yeah, a little afraid.
Naked and afraid. It's kind of like she felt.
Yeah, I don't know why you decided to play that. I feel like that's something you and I could have discussed off the air.
You know, we decided when we made this phone number that, hey, whatever call came in, we were going to play. We've always said, any fan feedback, we'll talk about on the show. And you know, technically, I mean, she sounds cute.
Well, she sounded pregnant to me.
That's true. Grouchy.
I agree that we did say that. I guess I just never saw the scenario. And again, hindsight.
Are you nervous at all? I mean,
absolutely.
Are you going to try to get legal counsel?
I'm going to try to get her and this unborn child down to Puerto Rico.
A flight of stairs. Oh.
Well, no, Puerto Rico. So let me take this opportunity to say that we are completely against Puerto Rico becoming the 51st state of the union. If we can maybe extradite her down there and then leave her there and then sever ties with Puerto Rico.
Right now you're sounding like Donald Trump. A minute ago you wanted to make them Puerto Rico a state, and now you're saying you don't.
I don't remember that. But, you know, Donald Trump and I, we do align on many of the issues. I'm working actually pretty closely with him on getting – like we're this close. And for people who can't see us at home, I'm talking like a millimeter away from getting Mexico to build that wall. And they're going to pay for it. They're going to build it and pay for it. And we're just – all of us on the other side, we're just going to stand there watching them with our arms folded like a bunch of old grumps.
All right. All right. Well, I got your back. As always, I got your back.
You know what? I feel like we just you and I almost just had an argument about –
Oh,
you know,
no.
But no, but say you saying that you have my back, it really makes me feel better about the whole situation. So,
yeah, I don't think we've ever had an argument.
No.
But, you know, I'm just concerned. I want to make sure you're on the level because having a child is a big responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
And this young lady sounds very, very adamant that she's going to make your life miserable.
You know what? I don't want to get into it right now.
Every woman I've had a baby with has made my life miserable.
Yeah.
Every one of them.
I will say that...
They've all been adorable, cute... wonderful, and as soon as that placenta blood came out, they hated me, and I'm worried that's going to happen to you too. Sorry.
Well, like I said, I don't want to get into this right now, but
all right,
I was introduced to this lady by DSJ.
Okay,
so I don't even know if this child is mine. So I just kind of
we'll leave it at that.
Ladies and gentlemen, the captains have turned on the fasten seatbelt sign.
Do you like podcasts? Does Flying the Friendly Skies fascinate you? Do television shows with only one episode keep you up at night? Call the Couch Pilots. We are all of those things. Get it?
I got it.
Good. Today we discuss the pilot episode of Stick Around from the year of our Lord, 1977. Great year.
Great year. 1977. I remember it like it was yesterday. I was 2 years old. Loving life. I had already had my surgery.
Yeah.
My open heart surgery, so I was still alive. I was I was glad to be alive.
Yeah.
Walking around, speaking Spanish, because in the hospital, I was roomed with a kid who was Spanish, and his mom only spoke Spanish.
Was this in Puerto Rico?
Oh, no, it's in Chicago.
Okay.
They left the radio on at night into a Spanish channel, and so I learned a little bit of Spanish at 2 years old.
So they always say, you know, if you want, like when I was young, we had to learn all these spelling words and everything. I was like, if I record my voice and then play it while I'm sleeping, I'll learn it.
Mm-hmm.
So
that osmosis. Happened to you. Osmosis.
So you knew through osmosis you speak Spanish.
I spoke Spanish. It's one of those things, if you don't use it, you lose it. My kindergarten teacher said that I was very good at rolling my R's. And in kindergarten, I was very bored, and so she taught me to count to 10 in Spanish.
Nice.
I mean, I could carry on a conversation in Spanish when I was 2, but when I got in kindergarten, I had to learn how to count to 10.
Gotcha. Makes sense to me. You know what else makes sense to me? Is us.
Cinco. Seis, siete, ocho, nueve.
Quinceañera, the celebration. No?
Nope.
Okay.
I don't remember that on the radio.
1977.
I was 2.
Great year. I was -4.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Such a youngling.
Yep. I was in heaven still, waiting to be put down that chute into my mother's womb. That's right. What do you think? You know what I imagine it? I imagine like God, like Santa Claus up there, like in the Christmas story when the kid goes up and he sees Santa.
Ho, ho, ho.
And then God put his boot on my face and he pushes me down the chute and I go... I think heaven is like it's just above where we fly in the ozone.
Right, right. We've been asked not to fly that high.
Yeah, we've been asked by a greater power not to exceed 10,000 feet, and so we've honored that.
Sure.
But sometimes we've talked about like highway hypnosis and the pilot version of that, seeing things in there. I swear to you, I have seen children shoot straight down from heaven, getting ready to be put into their mother's womb. I have no real proof. You do the stuff in the middle. I don't know.
Everything that happens in life doesn't need to be proven.
Exactly. Exactly. We don't need to tie up all loose ends, right? Let's go back in time to 1977. Let's think about the things that happened in that year so we can properly digest this pilot.
Best thing to do.
Starting with Jimmy Carter elected President of the United States. Peanut farmer.
He was a peanut farmer? Or liked peanuts?
He enjoyed peanut butter.
Peanut butter, and jelly. First you take the peanuts and you pick them. You pick them.
The show is built on the back of his songs. Is that it? You got to talk while I say that.
You pick some grapes, I think, and you jam them. But then it sounded inappropriate, and your son might be listening. Your soon-to-be son.
My soon-to-be son. Yeah, they do take in everything, including Spanish. President Carter grants a pardon to American draft dodgers of the Vietnam War period.
They were the worst baseball team in the history of baseball.
The American Draft Dodgers?
Yes. They were horrible.
And you know what's funny? Back then, great hot dogs. If you have an American Draft Dodger dog now, they're terrible.
Right. But back then, top notch.
That's the one you want.
Because they didn't skimp on quality. Nowadays, they're like, oh, we got to feed these 40,000 people. You know, back then, it was like, hey, we got to feed these 15 people.
That's right. What? When's the last time the American Draft Dodgers even made it to the playoffs?
Oh, jeez. It's been since...
Yeah, it's been...
72, I
yeah,
think.
That's exactly right. Yeah. That's exactly right. So thank God that President Carter granted them a pardon for being such an awful MLB baseball team. The Medal of Freedom was awarded posthumously. I never know if I'm saying that right. Posthumously. I think there's a TH there, but you don't say it like I think it's posthumously.
I've never heard the word in my life.
It's
say it in Spanish.
El posthumously.
I've heard that one.
Okay.
It was on the radio.
What's it? You know what it means still?
It means standing up straight.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right.
Being proud.
Mm-hmm. They awarded that to the Reverend, and here it says Martin, but it's Doctor. Let's call him right. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Amen.
What's that going to do for him after he's dead? Give it to him before he dies.
I noticed that. Like, they give, like, a lifetime achievement award to a musician or something that's been dead for 10 years. It's like, oh, what, so his grandkid who is just living off his money and doesn't have anything, you know?
Yeah, well, you're going to dig him up and throw it in his box?
You're going to put it in his museum that his wife has made to cash in on his death?
Story of my life.
Story of Hank Williams' life, too.
Yeah. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. What was he a doctor in, do you know? If I remember correctly, he was a dental hygienist. I could be wrong.
A dental assistant?
Well, he eventually got his DDS.
Oh. That's a great wrestling move.
It is. I think it's outlawed in Canada now, isn't it? There's too much risk of a spinal injury if you get a DDS.
Only the luchadors can do it. They do that down in Mexico.
Anything goes down there.
Oh, yeah. You can grab them by the balls.
Oof. The king, Elvis Presley, dies at the age of 42 from a heart attack.
Thank you very much.
You know what I'm going to say?
Thank you very much.
Is that what you're going to say?
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you very much. No.
Remember when you would say that?
Yeah, all the time, I remember. I'm going to say the same thing I say every time a musical person dies at an early age.
Here we go.
That's the only reason he's famous. That's the only reason everybody thought he was good, because he died early.
Elvis? I can see that for some folk, but Elvis? Come on. The guy had started in like 50 films.
He stole black music.
You're damn right he did. That's the American way, is to take from the black man and prosper from it. And then leave them wanting to He did it best. Elvis Presley, he robbed the black man best, I think. That's his legacy.
Well, you know, and here, you know, 40, you said 40-some years old?
42. You're almost 42.
I am, yeah. In a couple months, I'll be 42.
Criminy.
He died on the shitter, right? Or is that like old wives' tale?
I think he was pumping one out, and he probably was on a bunch of meds, too.
He was on a lot of drugs. He did a lot of drugs. Now, kind of like with Prince and, you know, Johnny B. Good.
Yeah, Johnny B. Good.
Like, you know what? You did this to yourself.
What did Johnny B. Good die of?
Like George Michaels?
Yeah.
I'm like, come on. You didn't die peacefully. You did drugs and died.
Sure.
So I can't feel bad for you. Prince, you were supposedly iconic.
Mm-hmm.
You did drugs. You died. You do drugs, you die. That's all I have.
That's just simple. It's just that simple.
David Bowie, he had cancer. Not his fault. Couldn't do anything about it. He dies, yes. Put him on a pedestal.
You don't think he earned that?
Who?
David Bowie.
I don't know.
You don't know.
But, you know, Elvis Presley, a lot of people cried. A lot of women cried. A lot of fat old women cried when he died.
Yeah.
You know?
He's a good-looking man.
Oh, well.
20 rolls around, he's got that guitar and he's shaking his hips.
Yeah, but about 33 rolls around.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, you know, he swells.
Metabolism slows down. The peanut butter and banana sandwich intake grows.
Yep. When you eat stuff like that in the middle of the night, you get a big old belly.
He was a black belt in karate.
Yeah, right. Sure he was. Wasn't he like a deputy or something?
He was the Steven Seagal of his time.
You know what? That's perfect. Didn't he meet like Richard Nixon? To get a badge to be like an honorary FBI guy or something.
This is a guy who, you know, at like 18 to 20, just had every girl pulling down their pants and had every bag of money backing up to his front door. Mm-hmm. He kind of had a Michael Jackson syndrome where no one ever said no, so he thought he could go around anywhere, dress as lavishly as he want, put any belts around his waist, get any medals from any, you know, diplomat or whatever. Sure. And he thought he was all that in a bag of chips. Turns out he was all that and dead on a toilet.
Very, very Steven Seagal-ish.
Yeah.
Love me tender.
That's the worst Steven Seagal I've ever heard. Why did we choose to watch Stick Around?
You think you can pick on him? How about you pick on me?
You always like picking on people smaller than you.
That's just like Elvis.
Why did we choose to watch this godforsaken pilot?
There's three simple criteria. A, it had to be a one-hit wonder. There was only one episode ever made. It never went to series. Whether it got shown or not, that's not in the cards. It's if there was one made, it didn't go to series.
That's right.
Two is that we had to be able to find it. You scour the internet looking for these.
Not always successful.
Right. If you don't find it, we can't watch it.
Well, how could we talk about it if we haven't seen it?
Exactly. And C, mm-hmm. we had to get it for free. It had to be no expense paid.
If it wasn't deemed worthy to put on the air, why am I going to pay money for
exactly.
it?
Exactly.
Why would I do that? You think I'm stupid?
I don't think you're stupid.
You better put those glasses back on, sir.
Gee, Christmas.
Gee, many Christmas.
Have you ever
indeed.
Just taken off a pair of sunglasses and just wanted to go,
No. I don't roll like that.
I almost threw up.
Where can you roll to watch Stick Around? Well, you can find the entire episode by subscribing to Couch Pilots in iTunes or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to YouTube, and you know what to do, too. Hey, you know what? You know what, buddy? You try to produce an hour and a half worth of content every week,
All right? You got something better you want to say?
No. It's as good as it's going to get.
It rhymes. YouTube, DoTube?
But DoTube's not a word.
Exactly.
Okay, I got it now.
I don't know why you're so down on that. I love it.
Flight attendants, prepare for takeoff, please.
Summary of the pilot. It's the year 2055, and things are better for the human race, except for Vance. The Kiefer family deals with daily life in the future and their older and malfunctioning robot servant, which Vance is tired of. Great summary.
It summarizes the pilot in a way that a summary needs to if it's on the internet.
That's right.
Plain and simple.
If you take a look at everything.
There's a lot of summaries you give us that are super wordy. There's some that are unwordy.
Yeah.
And this one's just wordy enough.
Perfect amount of words to summarize exactly what needs to be summarized. Whoops. Whoops you. Next section of the show. And again, we've talked about this plenty of times in the past. It's a section of the show that has divided families, crumbled governments, left beautiful acres of nature just left
burnt
a wasteland.
To the ground.
Just crisp, smoldering ashes. And the section's called Interesting Facts.
Yeah. Also, we have the Conrad Rule. That's what we call Conrad Rule.
The Conrad Rule, of course, is in play here. This is a section of the show where, like you said earlier, and I love the word scour because it really defines. There's no better word for it. I'm out there and I'm scrubbing and I'm looking at all the dark corners of the internet, all the places you at home are afraid to go, and rightfully so. And I find interesting facts, again, just the name of the section, but I find the facts out about the show that you wouldn't know just from watching it, and then I present them to you.
Right, and when we present them to you, you don't give your opinion. You don't get on our Facebook and post, wow, that was interesting, or this one was interesting. You don't look over at your best bud and say, man, you want to hear something super interesting? And you don't look at your girlfriend or fiancé or wife or mistress.
Right.
R.I.P. Alexander Hamilton. And tell them what you think of the facts. They're facts.
No, yeah.
Doesn't matter what you think. They're always going to be the way
they are. It's not going to change the fact. Just accept it and digest it. If you want to go home and scream in your closet what you think about it later, that's fine. But don't pollute someone else's mind.
Right.
Let them come to their own conclusions here on whether or not they're interesting, whether or not they're not interesting. And the facts go. Unsold television pilot for ABC starring Andy Kaufman. Only one episode was ever made, airing May 30th, 1977.
Okay.
Yeah. Whew. Yeah.
That's close.
I know. I can see it in your eyes. You want to comment? I don't blame you. I want to comment, too. But we're better than that. Andy Kaufman, you may know as Lotka from Taxi or his many confusing appearances on Saturday Night Live. Did you know he was on SNL?
I know he had been on SNL before. I didn't know how reoccurring he was.
I think SNL was much more kind of fluid, hippie scene back then.
Sure.
So they would just invite...
Drug-infused.
Oh, without a doubt.
I mean, they would have Paul Simon on
for... Cocaine-fueled Paul Simon. They'd have people on and people,
what I am is what I am, and you what you are, oh, why.
Great Paul Simon song.
A lot of people say, hey, Paul Simon. That's not a Paul Simon song.
No.
People don't know that he is married.
Eddie Brickell?
To Edie Brickell.
Edie, I'm sorry.
From Edie Brickell and New Bohemians.
Right. I thought it was Eddie. I thought it was a guy.
No.
It's
I'm
Edie.
Not aware of too many things. I know what I know if you know what I mean. The show was built on the back of his songs. Do ya choke me in the shallow waters before I get too deep?
Great song.
I could keep going.
I wish that you would. Andy Kaufman would
long
pop
enough for
up.
You to take a drink.
Andy Kaufman would pop up on SNL, and he would do very confusing things that he would do in the local New York scene that were just, they were odd, and they were like, it was absurdist.
Sure.
And almost anti-comedy.
Do you think that, and I was thinking about this earlier, and we can probably get into this later on, but I wanted, this is a perfect time to talk about it. Do you think he was like the first alt-comic?
I think many could point to him and say, yeah, he's the grandfather of alt-comedy for sure.
Okay.
That's a great, you know, a separate from Interesting Facts. Yeah, please bow. Please bow. You deserve every bit of that.
I knew that would make you proud of me.
I'm so proud of you today. I don't know why you look for my approval. I'm 6 years younger than you. This is an unhealthy relationship we have.
Many have said that.
Oh, no.
Including?
My wife.
My wife.
Stick Around has been called a live-action Jetsons. I get it.
Got it.
Good. Kaufman portrayed Andy, a rundown servant robot in the future. He used the same voice of his foreign man character that would one day become the signature voice of, again, Lotka Gravis on Taxi. And finally, Andy would revive the robot character to some degree in the 1981 film Heartbeeps.
You want
to
see something really cool?
I really do.
Last night, I was laying in bed with... And I thought to myself, self, what was the name of that movie? Because I've seen that movie, and look.
There it is, Heartbeeps.
Yep, Heartbeeps. Did you ever see this movie? It's interesting. What was the lady's name?
Bernadette Peters.
Yeah, Bernadette Peters was in it, and he was in it, and they were robots. They left. This is a whole different couch pilot. This is like movie couch pilots, but they left like this robot like warehouse or something to like form a family, and they had this little like Wally robot.
Yeah.
Why are you laughing at me?
I honestly have never seen it. I didn't look it up. I totally guessed Bernadette Peters, and you're not shitting. That's exactly what it was. I was just fucking around.
Fuck it, Bernadette.
I was just joking.
Oh, no, yeah. And she's weirdly attractive.
She really is.
She really is weirdly attractive.
For someone who has questionable size in his undergarments, the small mouth that Bernadette Peters has does gain you quite the... I mean, it's...
Shatter her dental.
Well, no, I'm just saying it bodes well for someone with a substandard member. Is what I'm saying.
Oh, okay.
Like, you want a small mouth.
So you were insulting me.
No, I'm talking about myself.
Oh, okay.
Like, I want a girl with small hands. I want a girl with a small mouth. That bodes well for me.
Right.
Okay? And Bernadette Peters is... Actually, I think she's got huge hands, if I remember correctly. About the size of a frying pan, if I remember correctly.
I think it was like that Jumanji gorilla that got shot.
Yeah. Harambe? Jumanji Harambe?
That was his God-given name.
I think Jumanji was okay. So like Kuta Kente, right?
Right.
So like he came over, he's like, "Your name's Toby," and then like just like they said to Harambe, he said, "Your name Harambe." He's like, "No, my name is Jumanji." Of course, that's how that.
If you're not having fun, what are you having?
Almost nothing at all.
Okay.
You may as well be dead, getting the Medal of Honor.
Right. If Lori Garcia's perky breasts are bouncing up and down right now from laughing, what more can I ask for?
I don't know anything about that. Twitter responses, they're all dead, so nothing. I saw you get excited for a second like we had something. We have nothing. They're all dead. Everyone's dead.
Even the buxom blonde?
I hope not. She doesn't have Twitter, though.
We'll get into that later.
We definitely will. And we'll also get into the pilot in just a moment, but not before we hear a commercial for one of my favorite shows, and that is Drunken Lullabies, right here on the FCF Network.
Hi, this is The Voice from Drunken Lullabies. Do you like craft beer, indie music, pop culture, pro wrestling, and pure juvenile hijinks? Then you will love Drunken Lullabies on the FCF Network. We have new episodes every Sunday, so you can spend the Sabbath getting drunk with us. So join me and my co-host Beer Mansky and our rotating cast of characters as we drink amazing beer, listen to bands we think you need to know, and laugh our asses off. Like Elvis said, 10,000 Drunkomaniacs can't be wrong. Check us out on all podcast platforms and at FCFnetwork.com. May your music be loud and your beers be cold.
All right, well, I guess, again, for another episode, the Black Magistrate has whipped out his ding-dong and just let it go.
Drunken Lullabies, right here on the FCF Network. Oh, boy. I love that Drunken Lullabies.
I love it. I've really been enjoying the episodes lately.
I believe that you have. And now, on with the pilot. Captain Rester, I love you. Can we just stop for a second? I love you.
I love you.
Summary of the pilot. Or not summary of the pilot. Complete and full plot
breakdown.
Of the pilot.
Yes, the breakdown from scene to scene.
You know, as we sit here today, beginning of 2017, so far, great year.
Great year.
This takes us into the future. April 9th.
Ironically, it's in the past, but it takes us into the future.
It's a real, it's a mind fuck, you know? Because it's 40 years ago. Right. Actually, exactly 40 years ago, almost, right?
Yeah, and it's a show about almost 40 years ahead of us.
Boy, it really messes with your head. April 9th, the year of our Lord, 2055. Hopefully a great year. And you get this kind of, it puts that on the screen. It's got some weird imagery, and it's got like that weird sci-fi alien kind of noise.
What is that thing that it's a...
Metrodome.
No.
Bernadette Peters.
It's an instrument, and you wave your hand across it, it uses electricity.
A Jew's harp.
No, it's...
Harpsichord.
Sheldon used it on Big Bang Theory.
I've never seen that. I would never watch that show.
What is that called?
Laser beam.
No.
Fun facts.
Okay. Anyway.
Two men at a table. Not having a baby at all. Playing what appears to be some version of chess. Right? And we've looked it up and it's a, what is this here? What have we got? Telegraph?
No, that's not.
Western Union.
No, it's not.
Sending money across the wire. I'll look at
it
later.
Forget it. All right. I should have written it down. Use your hand. It's electricity.
I really think it's a Jew's harp.
Yeah, so two guys are playing what seems to be chess, the concept of chess. But
maybe the evolution of chess.
Yeah, these humongous pieces.
Oh, I like them very much. And the man sitting there, we find out his name is Vance, he's playing this other fella, and he says he's programmed to lose.
Yeah, he's like, programmed to lose.
So he's like a robot or an android.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Vance was stressing it out very right off the bat that this was a robot.
Yeah. So we were, you know, right away, and everyone's dressed in the kind of the bright, bold colors, and it's very almost simplistic outfits to show that we are in the future.
And the men in this pilot have the hugest belt buckles.
All have the same belts.
They were like the rhinestone cowboys. They were huge belts that, if they were sitting down, would physically cut through your skin into your abdomen.
That's exactly right. All these belts are really big and fat, and every male, minus Mr. Burkett, who we'll find out later is from the past, mm-hmm. Have these belts on. And so he's sitting there, and they're playing chess, and he is getting frustrated that he is losing to this robot who he's programmed to lose.
Right.
I don't know why you do that. That takes the fun out of the game, doesn't it?
Hey, winning is everything.
I suppose
so. For some people, it's more important to win, and it doesn't matter how you win.
So they're playing, and then a woman comes in. We find out that's Vance's wife, Elaine. And again, you like that, huh? She's a good-looking woman. We'll get into that for sure. I've got some notes on that. And she comes in, and she's talking all this like kind of future garbage. Like, hey, we can program the terrace for sun later. We can have dinner outside. Hamburger is $52 a pound, or whatever it is.
And then she wants to know what time he wants to have dinner. And he's like, I don't care, whatever you want. And she's like, no, what time do you want? He's like, let the computer decide.
Everything seems like it's computerized or simulated. Right off the bat,
it's very thick. They're trying to establish how life is so dependent on electronics and computers.
How advanced all this stuff is, for sure. Then the robot wins, and then the woman looks at the camera.
Yeah, fourth wall broken right in first scene.
Immediately.
Which surprised me.
And the only time I think that it's broken throughout the show as well.
I believe so as well.
So she looks at the camera, and she's like, hey, you think things are complicated back in 1977. What about now?
Stick around.
Stick around, indeed. I have the...
Stick around. The theme song comes on. And it gives, like, within a song, and I wouldn't say it's a rap or anything, but within the song, it explains the storyline.
It says, stick around, stick around. There's a whole lot of joy to be found. Stick around, there's a whole lot of joy to be found. Here's a view of me and you in 2055. New machines and laser beams. Make sure we all survive. No traffic, no pollution. It's a new society. Food may be expensive, but the air is fit to breathe. Stick around. There's a whole lot of joy to be found. Won't you please stick around?
How do you have every word of that?
I've scoured.
You found the words to it?
Gosh darn it if I didn't scour.
That's awesome. High five that.
High five that. Nice.
Well, I'm taken aback. I'm verklempt. I am proud.
I scour. You know, that's what I do.
Then we go into the second scene, and Andy, the robot,
mm-hmm.
is standing behind a counter with Vance. And there's toasters, there's coffee pots.
I noticed a big like Coca-Cola sign in the back. So all these different things, and
which would be considered vintage
mm-hmm.
in 2055.
We find that they run and are working at like an antique shop or something.
Well, kind of like the place that you ran.
Absolutely. That's a lot exactly like right.
It was, yeah. And you see Andy, who is the robot, plug himself in with like a guitar amplifier cord.
Something. He's plugging it into his shirt.
Into his shirt. And Vance is like, what are you doing? He's like, I'm charging myself.
And this is the first time you hear Andy speak, and that was very good. I know you're proud of what you did, and I agree. You deserve to be proud. I, take that feeling. Run with it. And this is that Lotka voice, that classic mm-hmm. Andy Kaufman voice, whether he was doing the Mighty Mouse bit or whatever it was. This was the voice that we a lot of people recognize with him from Taxi. So he starts talking. He's like, I'm charging myself.
Good
and,
job.
Oh, thanks.
That is a great Nanu, you should have said Nanu with
that. Oh, R.I.P. R.I.N.C.E. Robin Williams.
No.
No? You don't want to rest in peace? Guy. What, Nanu? That was Robin Williams.
Plane. The little midget guy. Fantasy Island.
Oh, Tattoo.
Yeah.
Nanu Tattoo.
Didn't he say Nanu?
He said, the plane, boss, the plane.
Oh, there, that's better. Okay, anyway, I digress.
The power bill is high. Stop charging yourself. He's like, well, you're working me too hard. I've got to charge myself, or I'm going to power out. He says, why don't you just wrap this toaster, right?
Yeah, well, and he's Andy doesn't want him. He's like, I'll
you all right? Put those glasses back on.
All right. He's like, I'll plug myself in or plug myself out. He doesn't want Vance touching him. Sorry. So he's trying to wrap this toaster in like wrapping paper.
Yeah.
Making a complete mess. Tearing it and like getting in a fight with a tape dispenser.
He's like, "Hey, I don't have any vacuum packs. I have to use this old paper here."
Yeah, I don't like this paper.
It's not working out. And then the same customer who was buying the toaster says, "Hey, do you have any planters?" He's like, "Yeah, we got a 1976 model right here." And he rolls out a toilet with a plant in it. That's weird.
Yeah, that wasn't a good joke.
That wasn't a good joke.
But you will have your laugh track tell you differently.
The laugh track is extremely prevalent in this show.
And I had a hard time. I don't think that it was a laugh track to be ironic. It was a laugh track because in the 70s, everything was laugh track and it was supposed to be funny. Laid on thick.
The only reason it could even be remotely considered to be ironic is because Andy Kaufman is in it.
Right.
But other than that, you're right.
But how much pull did he have to...
This is pre-Taxi. You know, this is he's a punk running around the New York
scene. With a mole
scene.
On his face.
Exactly right.
R.I.P. So, Drew Brees.
R.I.P. what?
Drew Brees. He's got a birthmark.
R.I.P. Drew Brees, indeed. This is in the future, folks. Drew Brees is dead.
No, he just didn't make it to the playoffs.
For the longest time, I put Guy in here because I couldn't get Vance's name. How early did you get Vance's name?
They said it a couple times, but I put the guy for a long time, too. You just said it earlier.
Well, he's checking Andy for like malfunctions, and Andy's kind of embarrassed that he's like opening up his gutty works and looking at all his
right.
He's
like, don't do that here. Can't you do it in private?
Yep. And then another customer comes in, it's a guy who.
Well, he's like, Andy, you're having a breakdown.
Yeah, he's like, I'm not having a breakdown at all. He's like, yeah, absolutely you are, but in reality, he probably was because you find out later he was malfunctioning quite a bit. Another customer comes in. He says, hey, I like your heater there. And he's like, no, this is a lamp. He's like, don't tell me what that is. I'm from the 70s.
Right. I was frozen. I am, what is it?
I'm cryogenically frozen.
Cryogenically frozen. I've only been thawed out for a couple weeks, but I know what that is.
And it turns out that this cryogenic, or cryos, as the kind of derogatory slang is, they're kind of a second-class citizen.
Mm-hmm.
These are considered kind of old people from the past who have, for whatever reason, frozen themselves, whether it's a disease that they're trying to avoid or just mortality in general.
Sure. You know, they're looked upon in the society as, I don't know, lesser. Like the people, like the thieves.
This is a racial metaphor, if you ask
exactly.
me.
Exactly.
And they treat it just like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, and like... Obviously, too. Like, they're not trying to hide it at all.
Right.
But they treat it like that, and it's definitely a racial metaphor. And then we kind of see, you know what? This is for sure an antique shop. And the customer who comes in, who's the cryogenic guy, he says, you know, I've got this for you. Maybe you'd be interested in this. He pulls out a 38 special as a
an old 38 special. He's like, oh, I remember this. They made these in 38. He's like, no, it's 38
caliber. Come on, man.
And he's like, it's old fashioned. And he's like, yep, this is an old-fashioned stick-up.
Oh, boy, and he does. He sticks that 38 Special right up in his face, and he says, you know what, Andy, come on out here, and he kind of shields himself with Andy the robot.
And that's what I picture you doing to me if absolutely. We ever get held up. You're going to stick me right in front of you.
It's numbers. It's earning potential versus age. You're younger, when I do that in equation, right, you are going to stand in front of me every time.
Right, right.
So I do that, and I know just like you and Andy, neither of you are bulletproof, unfortunately, right?
Well,
are you, hold on. What are you saying?
I don't. What's this going on? I don't want to talk about how bulletproof I am.
All right. Oh, boy. Excuse me. Andy immediately hands the robber the money, and he says, I'll go to the back and get the rest
of it. Yeah, I'll get the rest of it. And then cuts out. And the next scene is Elaine is sitting on the couch, and she's, you know, he has those shoulder pad things, and that's what they use as, like, their. Where they're trying to fix
Andy
him.
The robot. Yeah, he's got these like little flaps on his shoulders, and they lift those up to work on him, right?
So Elaine is trying to fix Andy, and she has on a mini skirt.
I didn't notice this till later, but yes, she did.
And when I say mini skirt, I mean I've never seen a skirt, and it's real thin and real flowing.
I saw everything.
Yes. And at first I was like, maybe she's got leggings on. Maybe I'm just being a pervert. Maybe she has leggings on. I looked two or three times. I don't believe she had leggings on. This was a miniskirt, buxom blonde.
This is a future I want to live in.
Boing is all I can say is a boing. She's adorable face. I'm not really sure about the hair, but that's probably just for the show. And then if she would wear that flowing out. I like girls in flowing outfits.
Oh, yeah.
And all through this, she has the women in, you know, very flowing dresses and thin, so thin.
She's
I wish Andy would have dumped some water on her.
She is. She's working on Andy, mm-hmm. and she said, "Hey, Andy needs some laser mend." And then Vance is like, "You're always lasering him. You never laser me." Again, another as a sexual metaphor.
Yeah, right? Definitely. And this is where Vance really gets heated about getting rid of Andy, saying he's an out of date robot, mm-hmm. and he's very jealous of the relationship that Andy and Elaine have. Which come to find out later on, Andy has been with Elaine since she was a kid.
That's right. He's an ageless robot.
Which is
robot.
Even weirder, because why would you have sex with the... Or why would you frolic with the robot that wiped your butt and changed your diaper?
It's an Oedipus complex.
Oh, it's so far away.
Andy, yeah, he's out of date. He's got no feelings. And they're saying, you know, we're going to talk about this. So, Andy, why don't you go to your room? He's like, it's not a room. It's a closet. You put me in a closet.
Right.
And he says, you know what? He's walking to his closet. You know what? Vance hit me yesterday.
Yeah. It was. It changed from a sexual kind of condensation.
Right.
Sexual condensation. Mm-hmm. Then it went to like a child pitting his parents against each other. And it went that quick, weird way.
They play off like all that. These different dynamics
right.
like that
just
to make it fit
sure,
in the joke.
Sure, sure.
They do, and this is actually where I noticed that everyone had the same big fat belt with the shiny buckle. Mm-hmm. But yeah, every guy had that.
It looked
for
like
sure.
It had lights on it. I don't know.
The couple then argues about Andy, and Andy's kind of in the back eavesdropping. And that this is where you find out that he raised Elaine from when she was a little girl. The parents had paid like $1.5 million or something for this
right.
thing.
Yeah,
and they said, here, you go ahead and have him. I don't know if it's a wedding present or what it was, but he's a servant robot.
Well, it's like my mom. She just gives me shit all the time. Mm-hmm. She's like, oh, he has a house now. I'm just going to give him stuff every time he comes over that he has to take home. And so now it's not in her house. It's in my house.
That's right.
And so in 5 years from now, I'm like, this house is too small. There's no room. She'll just be like,
I can see your mom doing that.
Oh, going
she does it all. Oh, yeah, she does it all the time. Yeah. Perfect. We find out that Vance has had a Pete and a Mickey, and apparently those are all like other models of robots.
Right, right.
So he's well familiar with the servant robot game, and he is not impressed with Andy, and definitely looking ready to either melt him down for a scrap or sell him off to the highest bidder.
Right, ding dong.
Whoosh, door swipe. This took me all the way back to the second show we did, Clone Masters, when we had all those sliding doors.
I love sliding doors.
Love them. In walks Mr. Burkett. And this is when I noticed that this lady is wearing this flowing skirt. And I was like, something is happening here.
Right, right.
This is a sexual awakening for me in my mid-30s.
You've had a lot of sexual awakenings through
almost weekly.
Pilots.
Almost weekly I have a sexual awakening.
Yeah, Mr. Burkett is another... he was frozen. He's Cro-Logenic.
Yeah, he's Cro-Magnon. And he's only been out for a few weeks.
He looks like an old Jew. right?
Yeah, and he's dressed as such too. He has he has like 1977's garb on, so it's very different. He stands out from everyone else,
right? And he sits down and talking. I guess he lives across the hall, and he hasn't been unfrozen for very long. And then they start talking about Elaine's asking him about his wife, and she's like, he's like, yeah, she's still frozen. And she's like, oh, I'm sorry. He's like, no, I hope she stays that way.
I hope they don't find a cure for what she has or keep her frozen. I'm living the good life here. And so Andy's like, you know what? While you guys are out here talking, I'm going to do a bunch of housework. I'm going to take care of all these things, trying to make himself look good so they don't want to sell him. And he goes and he gets some drinks. He's like, you know what? Can we get some Vito Cools? And he comes out with a big tray of drinks. It looks well put together. And they're like, oh, perfect, the drinks. And then he walks right up the couch. He drops the tray on the floor, and they're like, this thing is malfunctioning.
Yeah, he walks onto the couch and up over the top of it, right between Mr. Burgess and Elaine. I mean, it's the physical comedy that that Andy Kaufman's known for.
And then his arm falls off.
Yeah, that was weird. Just like, it came straight off. It was really weird.
Right, and so it's kind of a big setup to the commercial break. It kind of fades out. They come back in, and then you got Vance and Elaine sitting in what looks to be like a big toaster. And I thought it was like some kind of weird, like, tanning booth or something.
Yeah, I thought it was like a spa kind of like tanning booth thing. And supposedly it was a harmonizer.
Yeah.
Because this is where you first see the other robot that, if I'm not mistaken, the other robot, the gay robot.
Oh, for sure.
Not to be confused with the pilot gay robot, but this guy is definitely a flamer.
With that, what was that? Who's that guy? Nick Swartzen.
Yeah.
This is for sure. Like, that's exactly what I wrote down later.
It was Earl.
Yeah, Earl's his name. He's definitely a gay robot, for sure. He's fully automated.
Goodbye, Earl. I need a drink. Let's go out to the lake. You know, goodbye, Earl. Dixie Chicks.
Love the
Dixie Chicks. Come on, don't act like you guys don't know who I'm talking about.
Honestly, that is the only Dixie Chicks song I know.
Marianne and Wanda were the best of friends all through their high school days.
This is about killing a man. Right?
Both members of the 4-H Club, both active in the FFA. This is back when they were super, super hot. Oh, God.
Is this Dennis Franz?
Hans?
Dennis Hans and Franz. Yeah, the Dixie Chicks definitely pumped my pants up. I tell you what, there's some good-looking broads.
I don't know who it was in real life.
Earl is fully automated. He has lifetime seals, and he's a little aggressive too. He's got some sass.
Yeah, he's got a lot of sassafras in him, and he ends up answering the door. Right? And who was it that came to the door this time?
I think it was Mr. Birkin again.
And they were in the harmonizer, and then they show them.
They emerge as if it's like a toaster. I don't know what it's doing to them, but it's supposed to kind of, like it says, harmonizer. It's supposed to make them feel better and get along better. And they do. They seem to come out. And Vance does not seem to like Earl very much. He says, this guy, he's kind of got an attitude. He's a
pompous asshole. Yeah.
And then you find out they're still rerunning I Love Lucy on TV, and everyone still loves it and watches it all the time.
Who wouldn't?
Earl briefly attempts to help Andy, and then Andy trips him.
Oh, that was it was great. That was one of the best little falls that they've had.
See Earl, you understand he's a robot, and you're like, oh, Andy's gone. He's not gone. He's in the back room, and he comes out when he like a few minutes late for the doorbell. And then, he's trying to fix him, and then he trips him, and he falls over. And you can at this point, you see Vance is kind of have a little soft spot for Andy. His heart
exterior cracks. He's like, I got Earl on one hand and Andy on the other. I'll take the broken old one that is not a pompous asshole.
That's right.
So then they sit down to have dinner with Mr. Burgess, and they're eating wood and drinking rubber.
That's right.
Because I guess food is super expensive in 2055, and so they've
found. So says the theme song.
So says the theme song.
It's right about this time that I really decided, yes, this is a gay robot that we're dealing with, and
that's fine with us.
Equal
opportunity robots for
robots
us.
Robots should have equal rights across the board. Even if a robot is
iRobot.
Even if it's
iRobot.
Don't
talk bad about iRobot.
I would never do that.
Okay. Paying homage to my man, Paul F. Tompkins.
All right.
Sorry. And, as soon as I said that, you were just wanting to keep going.
I knew what you were doing.
You were like, you know what?
Bathe
I'm going to give it to him because any chance to pay homage to some of my heroes.
That's right. So you find here that Earl costs $1.5 million. And then he's in the kitchen while they're talking. You find out about that, and you hear a big loud bang. Andy comes out with all the desserts. And they're like, hey, what happened in there? He's like, ah, nothing. I just had to open the window.
Right. And then all of a sudden, Earl comes out, and he's all dirty. He comes out into the room. He's all torn. His costume's all torn up, and he's all dirty.
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, he fell from, like, you know, 12 stories.
He looks like one of those old Warner Brother cartoons where they light a cigar and it blows up in his face. Right. That's what he looks like. He's covered in soot. And that was funny to me because he's like, well, what's, you know, Earl's in there. He's like, well, something about not if he could fly or something. When Andy said that line, that was the funniest line to me in the show. And then Earl's like, hey, you know what? This is going to cost you a lot of money. I'm going to go scan myself for damage. Right?
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
He's a self-scanning robot.
Yeah.
The kitchen doors swing. I noticed that too. I was like, why does the front door slide? But right. The kitchen doors swing.
Just for that old time feel, I guess.
I guess. Next scene.
I wrote did to did not for some reason. I don't remember what that was. It was a quote from Andy and did to did not. Maybe it was something to do with regards to flying.
Maybe so.
Sorry, my eyes are dilated.
Well, that's fine.
I'm sorry. I feel like I'm off my game.
We're doing all this stuff in the middle right now, and I'm a little nervous because of your medical predicament.
So I apologize. I apologize to the listeners, not to you.
Oh, thank you.
Because they're probably like, why is Blake off his game? Why is he letting, you know, why is he letting...
Jason. My name's Jason.
Jason take all the glory. And
yeah. Why am I getting all the glory? Lane decides, you know what?
You're right.
It's time. He could be a danger to us at this point. If he's throwing people out the window, who's next? We'll go ahead and sell it. But she's clearly upset because she's attached to him. She grew up with him.
Right. They have a kinship.
Oh, without a doubt. And then you got a guy. I don't know his name, but he comes over to buy the robot. And there's a lady with him.
Oh, my
gosh. And she's hot as hell, isn't she?
She's hot as hell, and she is horny as all get out.
Oh, my God.
She is...
Another flowing outfit.
You know what she reminds me of with her
Bernadette
hair?
Bernadette Peters.
Bernadette Peters. You're exactly right. And I think that's when it hit me, like when I was watching this, it hit me about Heartbeeps, because I couldn't remember the name of it, and I just put in, you know, images, I put Andy Kaufman robot, and then that came up.
It may not be a coincidence at all. If Andy Kaufman is the star and the motor behind this, maybe he's attracted to Bernadette Peters, wanted to get a Bernadette lookalike, and then worked with her in that movie Heartbeeps.
Yeah, I'm trying to, what year was 1981.
81 for Heartbeeps, 77 for this.
Okay.
They said, hey, look at all these gizmos and gadgets this robot has. Don't you want to buy him? He speaks in gibberish.
Yeah, and he's like, she's like, are you a good dancer? And Vance is like, yes, he's a great dancer. He's like, no, I don't want to dance.
But they do, and then like Andy gets so wrapped up, and he dips the lady and then kisses her.
Yeah, and then the guy's like, does he have a libidiator? A libidoator?
Yeah, something like libido. But yeah. Libido raider or something like that. And he's like, I don't like this at all. But the lady is into it.
Oh, she is so into it. And this is where the husband is like, let's get out of here. You know, I don't know if I want
it. She's like, hey, I'm in the book. Look me up. And you know what? There's no books now. There's hardly any books. Why is there books in 2055?
Yeah, look me up on the computers.
Andy appeals to Elaine's emotions and nostalgia to hang on to. This is really his last plea, saying, you know what? We've been through so much. I helped you when you were young. You know, I took care of you when you were sick.
Then the two of us need look no more. We both found what we were looking for. I am not going that high. I cannot do it.
Friend to call
his own.
It's
about a rat, not a robot.
He goes to leave, and he's like, I got to get out of here. And he's like, he goes to leave, and that couple is outside, ready. They're like, you know what? We will buy you.
Yeah, and the wife is the one that's saying, we've decided to buy you. And
she knows what fun she's going to have with
him. And Andy's like, no, that's not happening. He just slams the door on him.
And then the next scene, Andy is like in the basement or something, and he's attempting to commit suicide.
It reminded me of like the furnace. Like it was just, it was a big, huge metal thing that
like
really.
Like a power grid in their house.
Yeah, and he was hooking himself up with battery.
Like jumper cables.
Jumper cables.
It's like, he's going to blow his circuits.
Yeah, he's just going to try to kill himself with the jumper cables. Andy
and Vance are down there, and they're kind of having a heart-to-heart.
Sure, this is, you know, where they let their guards down. Vance lets his guard down, and they talk about their true emotional feelings for each other, and it come to find out they both really care about each other. Mm-hmm. Andy's like, Vance is like, but remember when that guy, you know, held up the store? And you just gave him the money, and he's like, yeah, I gave you the money so he doesn't kill you.
Yeah, this is your impression. This is just phenomenal work you're doing. Finally, some work you're putting into the show. It's fantastic.
Thanks.
Thank you.
And he convinces Vance that he likes him.
He's like, it's breaking my heart. And Vance is like, you don't have a heart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got something in here. I got some electronics. He goes, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to kill myself. And he says, you know what? You can stay. We'll figure this out. And then Elaine pops out of nowhere, and they all hug each other. And he's hooked up to this stuff, and he shocks everybody.
Yeah, he's like, oh, boy. And they all hug each other, and they all get electrocuted.
And, I mean, they don't die. I mean, maybe that's where it was just a special, and that's how it was supposed to end. But everyone gets shocked. That's the end. Here comes all the turbulence.
Please remain seated, as we are now crossing a zone of turbulence.
The show didn't work.
No.
We know that for sure. Why didn't it work?
Well, we have to stay in the mindset of 1977.
Right.
First of all, there's only about three different scenes. I mean,
as far as like sets?
Okay. Sets.
Yeah, yeah.
They were really cheesy looking sets. They were really atrocious. Sure. It was all just like that diamond plated metal.
Yeah, everything was like kind of like white and bright. And then
it was very bright.
So you've got the house, you got the antique shop, and then you got the power room or whatever that is.
This is pre-taxi, right?
Pre-taxi.
How many people were going to be into Andy Kaufman at this time?
He is an acquired taste to this day.
To this day.
This is too high concept. If I had to throw my two cents in, this is too high concept for the viewing public. Or set, you know, decades and decades, almost 100 years in the future. You're dealing with robot problems. Mm-hmm. It's a very sci-fi. It's not as like, you know, Lost in Space ran for a few seasons, and that was more kind of action, right?
Right.
This didn't have action.
No, this is all interaction between humans and robots.
You could qualify this as a sci-fi comedy, which we have seen in the past over and over.
Does not work.
Does not work.
If we were smart, we would have bought a spaceship instead of Air Force One.
That's exactly right. What would you have done to improve Stick Around? It's tough.
It is the show that it is. Part of me was like, well, you make Andy Kaufman the aggressor as opposed to, you know, the robot who's getting kicked around.
Mm-hmm.
But then that robot is his character. You know what I mean? That's
right. He's very meek and kind of quiet. Yes. And
he doesn't have a lot of facial expressions. He's very plain except for these voices and the few mannerisms he does, and that's mm-hmm. what makes him the way he is.
Right.
I don't know. The jokes were pretty probably very 77-ish, so you know, it's not very nuanced, it's not very clever. It's just very basic jokes.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's tough to say. It's a weird. They backed themselves into a weird corner with this.
And you know, maybe space themed shows weren't, you know, people didn't want to see space sitcoms.
Yeah, they definitely didn't. Well, Starstruck was in the 70s.
Primetime space sitcoms are not great.
I think Starstruck even came after this because it came after the big Star Wars in 77. Right. So this Starstruck was like 78 or 79. Mm-hmm. People just they didn't get it.
No.
They didn't learn.
No.
They don't
want to think about the future, man. Future's scary.
It is very scary.
People say the future's so bright, but it's also the future's so scary.
That's right. So bright, in fact, that you are wearing shades right now in preparation for the future.
I'm wearing them because the doctor said.
Oh, also that. Hey, come on now. I'm not trying to.
I've been trying to fly this in the middle the best I can, and I've stumbled. Yeah, I know I've stumbled. I'm not on my game.
You're doing fine.
But I got my eyes dilated. I'm wearing sunglasses in a dark room.
And I've got my eyes set on you.
I got my mind set on you. Set on you. If you're going to take some money. I don't know the words. A whole lot of spending money.
You ever hear Weird Al's version?
It's going to take plenty of money to do it right, y'all.
You ever heard Weird Al's version of that song?
Mm-mm.
He says, this song is just six words long. Pretty good. Pretty good parody.
Good job.
If this edit survived... You're gonna need to tone it down a little bit. And what I mean by tone it down is Andy Kaufman, like we said, is very acquired taste. So much so when he did similar characters on SNL, he had a thing where he said, hey, public, right into SNL, and you decide whether I stay on the show or not. And the public said, we do not want you on the show. Right. So they voted him off of Saturday Night Live, and I think after that, he never did come back.
Right.
And that's kind of how this is treated. You know, this is only one episode. People probably did not care for his style.
And that's what it is. Is he was such an acquired taste.
Very alt.
Very alt.
Alt
before alt was alt. And so that's it just didn't work.
I agree. Let's bring this in for a final descent.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we start our descent, please make sure your seat backs and tray tables are in their full upright position.
IMDb score, care to take one stab?
5.4.
Are you fucking with me? That's exactly right, you bastard. 5.4 it is.
I've been so close so many times, but I know it's 5.4.
You're exactly right. And that's from 18 reviews. Not seen very much.
No.
The YouTube videos that we watched, because we went to YouTube and we know what to do, Tube. Oh, boy, you're just alienating everyone around you. There's over 11,000 views on YouTube.
Wow.
So, I mean, it kind of has been seen and kind of not.
Sure.
It's kind of in that middle there. Not so much so, though, that I really had trouble finding reviews, whether they were viewer reviews or critic reviews. But I did find one online that says, didn't stick around much. Get it?
Ha! That guy's a regular comedian.
6 out of 10 scars. Author Militant of Nothing from the USA. Before Taxi, there was a pilot called Stick Around, and like Taxi, this show focused on the year 2055, where people have robots as servants. The show sticks to the traditional sitcom formula, but the year that it's based on makes it much more original. The pilot focuses on a couple and their robot servant, Andy Kaufman, who appears to be a much older model, which explains the reasons of all of his malfunctioning. Despite
is this a summary of the pilot?
It is, but it's the only thing we have, so sure. I'm gonna burn a minute on it. Despite that, the show had way more potential than Taxi, it didn't go further than the pilot, which is a total shame.
Who would say that has more potential than Taxi? That's stupid. That really is a dumb thing to say.
The oddness and the tininess that is Danny DeVito opens the door for everything. So,
well, and the good looking guy that was on there, the young guy, he was.
Oh, they had Tony Danza was on there.
Yeah, but not Tony Danza. I mean, he was on there, but the guy from Grease.
Oh, Jeff Conway.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they had a hot guy. I don't think Danny DeVito was the one that carried that into syndication.
He's an anomaly. He's the Mason Reese of Taxi, I would say. And you know what? Let's just take this opportunity right now to close the book on Mason Reese forever.
We'll never talk about him again.
I believe Andy Kaufman playing an incompetent robot goes more with his unique persona in acting. Fans of Andy Kaufman definitely should give this a look. I think he's right when he says that playing an incompetent robot goes with his – because an incompetent robot is a bizarre thing, and Andy Kaufman is a bizarre thing.
Here's a quick one for you. What about instead of a robot living with a family, what if it's set in like an office and he is that weird, quirky guy in the office?
Okay, so not a robot at all.
Not a robot. He's just in an office setting with maybe five, you know.
And he's an engineer. That makes sense, right?
Well, yeah, you know what I mean, but maybe wouldn't that be more relatable?
Maybe. Because like I said, instead you know, putting in the future, it's a high concept thing. Yeah, that could maybe work for sure. But let's see what we have to say about this.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to FCF Airport. Local time is 11:11, and the temperature is 69 degrees. For your safety and comfort, please remain seated with your seatbelt fastened until the captains turn off the fastened seatbelt sign.
Landing the plane.
Thank God you were doing that, because I'm a little queasy.
Thank God DSJ was down here waving those golden cones.
It's good to have him back, man.
Absolutely.
I feel safe. I feel like we're at home.
Absolutely. Based on the scale set forth by Wings, the classic 90s television show, the 1 to 7 rating, the lowest you can get, a Roy Biggins, one of the characters on Wings, all the way to the best. Number one, A-OK, America Forever. Brian Hackett at number 7. Captain Philip Restisher, I turn to you. How do you rate Stick Around?
Okay, it's been a while since we've had a Buxom Blonde bump. I gotta give it.
You really do.
There's a white-haired Buxom Blonde, and there's a regular Buxom Blonde.
Yep.
And hey, foreshadowing. Next week, I'm giving a Buxom Blonde bump too.
Nice.
I like Andy Kaufman. As mm-hmm. weird as he is, I like it. I like him because he makes you feel uncomfortable when he's talking.
Yeah.
And I like that in a comedian. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give it a 4.
You and I are aligning so much lately. High five it. Ow. Oh, man. I've never done that many in a row. Too many high fives.
Too many high fives.
I agree. This is right down the middle. I was very excited because, as you say, he's the kind of the Andy Kaufman's that grandfather of alt comedy, that bizarre, absurdist awkwardness that is him. Some would even say the genius that is Andy Kaufman. So to have a pilot at all that we could find and locate and watch, like stick around, it was very exciting to me. It was not great.
No,
it was not terrible.
No,
I think this, just like you said, is
as bad as
a
tribe.
Oh boy, and I'll never watch it ever. Not even at gunpoint. Not even if someone stuck a .38 caliber in my face. This is a 4. This is right down the middle. It could have been a lot worse. It could have been better. I was excited to see it. Unfortunately, I can't go any higher than a 4, though. I would say if you are a fan of Andy Kaufman, watch this show.
Oh, yeah, definitely watch it.
Watch it. You might find something you like in there, and you'll get a complete look at the legacy that is the weirdness of Andy Kaufman. And with that, we close the door. Oh, boy. Pardon you. We close the door on Stick Around, never to be mentioned again.
Ever.
We'll never talk. There's no reason to.
Talk about Andy Kaufman again or this show?
The show. And but we're not done.
We're never done.
There's so much more work to be done, and we're here to do it.
We've invested money in this plane. Mm-hmm. We've invested time in this podcast. We have invested for one reason and one reason only.
Mm-hmm. What's that?
Listeners.
That's exactly right.
I was going to say bitches, but I think listeners are more appropriate.
Join us next time, won't you, when we watch the pilot episode of Bag Boy. Here's a little something to wet your whistle. Dr. Steve Brule directs himself in the title role of a rejected sitcom pilot about a Myers Superfoods bag boy who must decide whether or not to report a shoplifter. You can find the entire episode by subscribing to Couch Pilots in iTunes or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to Adult Swim and
you know what to do.
Damn it. Or I was going to say you can go to adultswim.com and search Bag Boy. But yes, or you could do tube.
Classically blue links. It's all,
What does that mean? What does that even mean?
It just means that those links are safe. They're not going to take you to a porn site. They're not going to make pop-ups come all over. They're not going to get a virus. It's not going to affect your sound card, which... I'm so pissed, but I have an issue with my sound card on my laptop, and I know what it's from. It's from going to that website that was not blue when the YouTube rip sites went down. Mm-hmm. There was one left. I know that's what it was.
And you got Duke-tubed.
I got Duke-tubed.
Duke-tubed.
Them Duke boys are at it again.
Oh, boy. Go to couchpilotspodcast@gmail.com. Let us know about the viruses you have on your computer. Tell us about pilots that you are aware of that we don't know anything about. We'll move them to the top of the list.
We want to hear from our listeners.
Yeah.
It's very important for us to get that kind of feedback. For our egos, mm-hmm. top notch.
Yeah.
Show content, top notch.
Yeah.
But just to know that people are out there listening. And we like to interact with you guys. You ask Lori and Big Dick T mm-hmm. and Conrad what's the best part of their week.
Yeah.
And it's when they interact with us on this show.
They say the sun comes up Monday morning. They put both their arms up in there and stretch, right?
Yes, and I'm gonna offer 1 million frequent flyer guys.
No,
listen, 1 million frequent flyer points. If the first listener that can tell me what error was made on the show art, for Boo Boo Runs Wild, there was error made on the show art. If somebody can tell me, first one that's up, 1 million points.
Wow. And speaking of 1 million points. And
1 million points.
And all these different ways to contact Couch Pilots, it all gets filtered through the non-electrical, gear-oriented Rube Goldberg device that is the Al Pacinco machine.
Love the Pacinco machine.
It's working overtime, so much so that we are looking into actually purchasing another one. Can we afford it right now? Absolutely.
Because it's got to be custom built from Sweden. I mean, they don't. There's only three of these. One of them's at Holiday World mm-hmm. in Santa Claus, Indiana.
Yeah,
we have one. We have one here, and the other one nobody knows where it's at.
Some believe that it was on the Titanic and it was being shipped across seas, and it went down with the ship. And only James Cameron knows the answer to
going
that.
Going down with the ship, but deep down in the sea, going down. Pirate's life for me.
So whether or not James Cameron is going to go in his submersible and find us that pachinko machine, or we're going to
sitting in a summer submersible, there's only one thing.
Are you proud of yourself?
That was, you know who that was?
No.
That was a little Howard Kramer.
Is it?
Mm-hmm. Summer Submersible off his new album, Summitology.
Did you download it?
I bought it.
What's it called? What's the name of the song? Summer Submersible?
Yes. It's about him going in a submarine and getting in a fight with Vladimir Putin. And the name of the album...
Of course it is.
...is Summer Submersible. Wait, no. It's Octolus Summer is the name of the...
Oculus Summer?
Oculus Summer is the name of the album. It's five-song EP... And it basically takes you through all the seasons.
Couch Pilots Podcast on Facebook, Couch Pilots Pod on Twitter, Instagram, Couch_Pilots_Podcast. If you have those things, follow us on those things.
Definitely.
Go to FCFnetwork.com. All the family of shows right there, all free. All free for the taking.
Yeah, I mean, we're giving stuff to you for free.
That's right.
The government's not going to do it.
No, they hand out cheese, and it's not even real cheese. It's a mixture of oils and salts. But we'll do better than that. We'll give you an array of surprise prizes. We'll give you signed aviator glasses, right? Yeah. Sometimes you can even take a flight with us if you have enough frequent flyer points.
I'm going to up it up a little bit more.
What are you
doing? A million
doing?
Frequent what? Flyer points, and the first person to contact us, tell us what's wrong with it.
Boo Boo Runs Wild show art.
They will get a signed autographed copy of that show art.
Wow. Unbelievable. Anything else you want to mention to our frequent flyers before we go?
No, I just wanted to... I just want to tell everybody that, you know, thank you for listening. All our Australian fans, good day.
Yeah, and good night.
Boomerang. Right. You know, so, yeah.
It's Australian for
me. I never really have anything to say. No,
doesn't stop you. And with that, this pilot may have been rough, but it's always a smooth flight here on Couch Pilots. Thank you, everyone, and we'll see you next time.
On behalf of Couch Pilots and the entire crew, we'd like to thank you for joining us on this trip, and we are looking forward to seeing you on board again in the near future. Have a nice day!
This has been a Fakakta Comedy Funhouse production, produced by Jason Tosher, executive produced by Blake Clayton. For more information and content, go to FCFnetwork.com.